Students, only 10 has joined from your class yet. Drop a message in your WhatsApp group to join the class as soon as possible. We are going to start with the first module today. We have completed 3 modules, 3rd module, 4th module and 5th module. We are going to start with the 1st and 2nd module from today. So the 1st module is about ARM controller. The architecture of ARM, what is there in ARM, what are the different families of ARM we have, all those things we are going to study, and what are the different register sets we have, what are the different types of special function registers, how many interrupts we have, all those things we are going to discuss about this thing, these concepts in the first module. In the second module, we will be going to learn about the different instruction set of ARM. Only 12 have joined till now. Okay, so the first module, the name of the module is ARM 32-bit microprocessor or microcontroller. Usually this ARM, any of the processor, it cannot be categorized both as a processor and a controller, right? Microprocessor is nothing but the processing unit, that is nothing. Like memory, ports, all those things, if you are adding one after the other to them, so then it is said to be controller. So by default, any system is said to be a processor if it has only the processing unit, and the system is said to be a controller if the microprocessor will be acting as a core of a system with some additional components such as memory, ports, peripherals, hardware devices, sensors, actuators, all those things. So this ARM 32-bit, whatever the ARM that you are going to study is a 32-bit processor, means maximum 32-bit size operation you can perform. 32-bit addition, 32-bit subtraction, division, multiplication, all those things. So even it is not that you need to give a maximum 32-bit value, you can start with even 8-bit value or a 4-bit value. That is the minimum value, and the maximum value can be of size 32-bit. So beyond this 32-bit, we cannot operate on this particular ARM processor. So ARM, the abbreviation of ARM is advanced. R stands for risk, M stands for machine. A stands for advanced, R stands for risk, M stands for machine. Advanced risk machine. So the abbreviation of ARM is Advanced RISC Machine. So this ARM 32-bit processor or controller which you are going to study is a part of your academic as well as your lab. So you are going to use the ARM controller in your lab in order to do your different hardware programs in the embedded controller lab you have. So Advanced RISC Machine. So as the name only indicates, that this processor or the controller follows the RISC architecture. So what do you mean by RISC architecture? So RISC is nothing but reduced instruction set computing. You'll be having less number of instructions, means more number of bit handling instructions will be there. The circuit complexity can be reduced as you have more number of bit handling instruction. If circuit complexity is reduced, then less amount of silicon can be used in the designing of that particular processor or a controller. And it takes less amount of machine cycles for executing the different instructions. So this is about ARM. So whichever the ARM that you are going to study, means all the ARM family, it can be a processor or the controller, it will be following the RISC architecture here. That is what you want to know. So we'll just see what when the ARM was invented and what was the name previously, what were the vendors we have, what are the different companies that will produce the ARM processor or the controller, about the background verification of the ARM that we are going to see now. So the ARM was formed in the year 1990, and as you know, ARM stands for Advanced RISC Machine. So it was started by 3 different companies together. One was the Apple Computer, Acorn Computer Group, and VLSI Technology. So actually, the recent name changed to, means the first previous name when it was invented, ARM was Acorn RISC machine. It was Acorn because it was one of the company which has invented this ARM. But later on, it was changed from Acorn RISC machine to Advanced RISC machine. Okay, in 1990 it was invented. Next, in 1991, ARM introduced a set of processor families. The first set of processor families which was involved or introduced into the market was ARM6 processor families. And these ARM6 processors was licensed by the VLSI technology company here. So the main thing which you need to know is that this is not only the company, but these three companies started at the point at the initial point of ARM, but later on many companies we have, which includes Texas Instruments, NEC, Sharp, then ST Microelectronics, and these are the different companies which will produce the licensed version of the ARM processors. Okay, licensed version in the sense means the manufacturers will be different, but these companies will give their name to the manufacturer product. If suppose nan enadru ond product tagothini andre aa product na nan ond company ge sell martini, aa company avar hesarinda adana market ge tagon bartare. So that is what this happens. Even this ARM processor, whatever you have, the ARM company will not develop these processors. You have set of these companies which will produce the processors, but the ARM will market all these processors under their name. Okay, so where can you find applications? Ellal use madabodu andre you can use those in mobile phones, computer hard disk, PDAs, that is iPads, all those things, home entertainment systems, and many other consumer products. So you have n number of applications where you can find the usage of ARM. So in market we have 8-bit processors, controllers, and 16-bit processors and controllers. So these processors and controllers were used for designing the low-end embedded system, where speed is not considered as a primary factor, time is not considered as a primary factor, only cost is considered as a primary factor. So with less amount of cost, if you design any embedded system, then you can go for the 8-bit or 16-bit processor. So similarly, if you want to overcome the other than the cost parameters, that is time as well as the processing speed, then you can use this particular ARM processors. So that's what I told you. ARM does not manufacture any processor or sell the chips directly. So this ARM licensed the processor designs to the business partners. So I had told you these are the different business partners they have. So these companies will be producing the processors, and the ARM will give its name or it will license those processors and allow to the market that those are the processors which are designed by their business partners. So that business model is called as intellectual property licensing. Okay, so in addition to this processor design, ARM also licenses different intellectual properties of different softwares related to ARM. So in order to develop the different firmware programs by using the ARM technology or ARM processors or controllers, even intellectual property licensing will be provided by the ARM company for the software products as well. So basically, what do you mean by ARM? What is ARM? ARM is nothing but Advanced RISC Machine. Before this name, as I told you, it was named as Acorn RISC Machine. Later on, the name has been changed to Advanced RISC Machine. So what are the features of ARM? The circuit is of reduced complexity, low power consumption, small in size. So this is best suited for the devices where size is considered as a primary factor. So ARM is of 32-bit size as well as 64-bit size processors. Both the processors will be following the RISC architecture itself. And also you have one more advantage where ARM follows this multi-core processing system. So multi-core processing system in the sense, one day system only if you have more than one processor. I think you people have heard about quad-core processor, pentacore processor, all those things. So why do you require more than one processor for a system? In order to increase the speed of a system. So ನೀವು ಯಾವುದಾದ್ರೂ ಕೆಲಸನ ಜಾಸ್ತಿ ಮಾಡಬೇಕು, ಎಫಿಷಿಯನ್ಸಿ ಜಾಸ್ತಿ ತೋರಿಸ್ಬೇಕು ಅಂದರೆ ಸ್ಪೀಡು ಜಾಸ್ತಿ ಇರಬೇಕು. ಬಟ್ ಈಚ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಎವ್ರಿ ಪರ್ಸನ್ ವಿಲ್ ಬಿ ಹ್ಯಾವಿಂಗ್ ಹಿಸ್ ಓನ್ ಲಿಮಿಟೇಷನ್. ಸೊ ಇನ್ ಆರ್ಡರ್ ಟು ಓವರ್ಕಮ್ ದಟ್, ಇನ್ ಆರ್ಡರ್ ಟು ಮೇಕ್ ದ ವರ್ಕ್ ಟು ಬಿ ಡನ್, ವಿಲ್ we'll do the work in a team so that the work will be completed in a faster way with less amount of time. The similar concept will be applicable here also. You suppose 4-5 applications different aag run maartirthira nim phone allene WhatsApp open maartira. Next Gmail open maartira, you can open YouTube, all these applications parallelly you can open and all the things will be running at the background, but one thing will be active at the front end, right? Means all the applications will be handled by different processes here. So in order to make all the processes to work in an efficient way and all the applications to run in an efficient way, we are going for, rather than using a single processor, we are going for multi-core. If any system, if it is having more than one processor as a system core, then it is said to be a multi-core system. So if you have the multi-core ARM processor system, the processing speed will be million instructions per second. So more million number of instructions can be executed within 1 second if due to the ARM multi-core processing system. So ARM is categorized into three different families. One is Cortex M family, Cortex A family and Cortex R family. So Cortex M is nothing but M stands for microcontroller. So wherever you are using embedded system design which is developed by a microcontroller, then you can use this Cortex M family of ARM. So similarly, Cortex A stands for application oriented. So wherever you want to design your own application and you want to use means that particular application can be used only with respect to that processor, then you can go for Cortex A. One best example is the Apple phone. ಈಗ ಆಪಲ್ ಫೋನಲ್ಲಿ ಯಾವುದಾದ್ರು ಪ್ರೊಸೆಸರ್ ಯಾವ ಪ್ರೊಸೆಸರ್ ಯೂಸ್ ಮಾಡ್ತಾರೋ ಆ ಪ್ರೊಸೆಸರ್ಗೆ ಅದರದೇ ಸೆಟ್ ಆಫ್ ಅಪ್ಲಿಕೇಶನ್ಸ್ ಇರುತ್ತೆ. ಬಟ್ ದಟ್ ಈಸ್ ನಾಟ್ ದ ಕೇಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಆಂಡ್ರಾಯ್ಡ್ ಫೋನ್ಸ್. ಆಂಡ್ರಾಯ್ಡ್ ಫೋನ್ಸ್ ಈಗ ನಾರ್ಮಲ್ ತುಂಬ ಜನ ಯೂಸ್ ಮಾಡೋದು ಆಂಡ್ರಾಯ್ಡ್ ಫೋನ್ಸ್ ಬಿಕಾಸ್ ಎನಿ ಕೈಂಡ್ ಆಫ್ ಅಪ್ಲಿಕೇಶನ್ ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ಬಿ ಡೌನ್ಲೋಡೆಡ್ ಇನ್ ಆಂಡ್ರಾಯ್ಡ್ ಫೋನ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ವಿ ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ಎಕ್ಸಿಕ್ಯೂಟ್ ದಟ್ ಆನ್ ಅವರ್ ಫೋನ್. ಬಟ್ ಇನ್ ಕೇಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಆ್ಯಪಲ್ ದೇರ್ ಆರ್ ಓನ್ಲಿ ರೆಸ್ಟ್ರಿಕ್ಟೆಡ್ ಸೆಟ್ ಆಫ್ ಅಪ್ಲಿಕೇಶನ್ಸ್ ವಿಚ್ ಆರ್ ಓನ್ಡ್ ಬೈ ಓನ್ಲಿ ದಟ್ ಮೀನ್ಸ್ ವಿಚ್ ಆರ್ ಸಪೋರ್ಟೆಡ್ ಬೈ ಓನ್ಲಿ ದಟ್ ಪರ್ಟಿಕ್ಯುಲರ್ ಓಎಸ್. ಇನ್ ಸಚ್ ಕೇಸ್ ದ ಸಿಸ್ಟಮ್ ಕೋರ್ ವಿಲ್ ಬಿ ಕಾರ್ಟೆಕ್ಸ್ ಎ. ಮೀನ್ಸ್ ಯು ಆರ್ ಡಿಸೈನಿಂಗ್ ಯುವರ್ ಓನ್ ಅಪ್ಲಿಕೇಶನ್ ಟು ರನ್ ಆನ್ ಯುವರ್ ಓನ್ ಸಿಸ್ಟಮ್, ದಟ್ ಈಸ್ ಸೆಟ್ ಟು ಬಿ ಕಾರ್ಟೆಕ್ಸ್ ಎ. ನೆಕ್ಸ್ಟ್ ಯು ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಕಾರ್ಟೆಕ್ಸ್ ಆರ್. ಸೊ ವೇರ್ ಎವರ್ ಯು ಆರ್ ಡಿಸೈನಿಂಗ್ application related to real time environment. So R stands for real time. So whenever you are designing any application related to real time, you need to use certain processor which should process the given input within specified amount of time. Delay irbardo, within less amount of time it should process. Neevu input kottid takshna lag madhyadalli within the system components there should not be any lag. Lag in the sense there should not be any latency. It should produce the output. The speed should be high. If you are considering this as the parameters, you can go for Cortex R. So as I told you, you have three different families. Within that, you have Cortex M. M stands for microcontroller. Cortex A. A stands for application oriented. Cortex R. R stands for real time. So the one which you are studying for your syllabus is Cortex M family ARM. This is the basic ARM processor which was introduced to perform or to design any of the low end embedded systems. So next we will see the different things. What is Cortex M, Cortex A, Cortex R? So first we will see what is the ARM Cortex M3 processor. So as I told you, this is the first generation of the processor which was introduced into the market in the year 2006. So this Cortex M family has different set of processors. Cortex M another one the family adrally eshto on the processors design madidara. So you have Cortex M0, next you have Cortex M1, next you have M3, next you have M5, next you have M6 and M7. So these are the different set of Cortex M family processors or the controllers which you have. Okay, so for your syllabus you are going to learn about Cortex M3. So as I told you, this processor is a 32 bit size processor. Maximum you can perform 32 bit operation here. And this Cortex M3 is more efficient processor with respect to its speed. So it operates in higher speed, as this is the basic versions of the Cortex processor. Within the basic versions, this Cortex M3 has higher operating performance. So this is about Cortex M3. So this Cortex M3 can also be called as a processor, or it can also be called as a controller. So how come the same thing can be called as a microprocessor or a microcontroller? ಕಾರ್ಟೆಕ್ಸ್ ಎಂ ತ್ರೀ ಅನ್ನೋದನ್ನು ನಾವು ಪ್ರೊಸೆಸರ್ ಅಂತ ಕಂಟ್ರೋಲರ್ ಅಂತ ಎರಡನ್ನು ಹೆಂಗೆ ಕರೆಯೋಕ್ಕಾಗತ್ತೆ ಅನ್ನೋದನ್ನು ಹೇಳ್ತೀನಿ. ಸೊ ವಾಟ್ ಎವರ್ ದ ಕಾರ್ಟೆಕ್ಸ್ ಎಂ ತ್ರೀ ಸಿಸ್ಟಮ್ ಕೋರ್ ಯು ಹ್ಯಾವ್, ದಟ್ ವಿಲ್ ಬಿ ದ ಪ್ರೊಸೆಸರ್ ಯೂನಿಟ್. ಓಕೆ, ಸೊ ದ ಸಿಸ್ಟಮ್ ಕೋರ್ ದ ಆರ್ ಎಲ್ಸ್ ದ ಕಾರ್ಟೆಕ್ಸ್ ಎಂ ತ್ರೀ ಕೋರ್ ಪ್ರೊಸೆಸರ್ ಈಸ್ ಸೆಟ್ ಟು ಬಿ ದ ಮೈಕ್ರೋ ಪ್ರೊಸೆಸರ್. ಇಫ್ ಯು ಆರ್ ಆ್ಯಡಿಂಗ್ ದ ಪೆರಿಫೆರಲ್ಸ್, ಮೆಮೋರಿ, ಕ್ಲಾಕ್ ಅಂಡ್ ರಿಸೆಟ್ ಸರ್ಕ್ಯೂಟ್, ದಟ್ ಈಸ್ ಆಸಿಲೇಟಿಂಗ್ ಸರ್ಕ್ಯೂಟ್, ಇನ್ಪುಟ್ ಔಟ್ಪುಟ್ ಪೋರ್ಟ್ಸ್, ಆಲ್ ದೋಸ್ ಥಿಂಗ್ಸ್, ಇಫ್ ಯು ಆರ್ ಆ್ಯಡಿಂಗ್ ಅಲಾಂಗ್ ವಿತ್ ದ ಸಿಸ್ಟಮ್ ಕೋರ್, ದೆನ್ ಎ ಪರ್ಟಿಕ್ಯುಲರ್ ಔಟ್ಪುಟ್ ಸಿಸ್ಟಮ್ ವಿಲ್ ಬಿ ಪ್ರೊಡ್ಯೂಸ್ಡ್, ವಿಚ್ ಇಸ್ ಕಾಲ್ಡ್ ಆಸ್ ಎ ಮೈಕ್ರೋ ಕಂಟ್ರೋಲರ್. ಸೊ ದರ್ ಇಸ್ ನೋ ಮಚ್ ಡಿಫ್ರೆನ್ಸ್ ಬಿಟ್ವೀನ್ ಪ್ರೊಸೆಸರ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಅ ಕಂಟ್ರೋಲರ್ ಹಿಯರ್. ದ ಪ್ರೊಸೆಸಿಂಗ್ ಯೂನಿಟ್ ವಿತ್ ಇನ್ ಎ ಮೈಕ್ರೋ ಕಂಟ್ರೋಲರ್ ವಿಲ್ ಬಿ ಕಾರ್ಟೆಕ್ಸ್ ಎಂ ತ್ರೀ ಪ್ರೊಸೆಸರ್. ಸೊ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಒನ್ ಮೋರ್ ಥಿಂಗ್, ದಿಸ್ ಕಾರ್ಟೆಕ್ಸ್ ಎಂ ತ್ರೀ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ದ ಡಿಬಗ್ ಸಿಸ್ಟಮ್, ಓನ್ಲಿ ದೀಸ್ ಟೂ ಥಿಂಗ್ಸ್ ವಿಲ್ ಬಿ ಡೆವಲಪ್ಡ್ ಬೈ ಆಮ್ ಹಿಯರ್. ಸೊ ರೆಸ್ಟ್ ಆಫ್ ದ ಥಿಂಗ್ಸ್, ವಾಟ್ ಎವರ್ ದ ಕ್ಲಾಕ್ ಸರ್ಕ್ಯೂಟ್ಸ್, ಇನ್ಪುಟ್ ಔಟ್ಪುಟ್ ಪೆರಿಫೆರಲ್ಸ್, ಮೆಮೋರೀಸ್, ಆಲ್ ದೋಸ್ ಥಿಂಗ್ಸ್, ದಿಸ್ ವಿಲ್ ಬಿ ಡೆವಲಪ್ಡ್ ಬೈ ದ ಡಿಫ್ರೆಂಟ್ ಅದರ್ ಮ್ಯಾನುಫ್ಯಾಕ್ಚರರ್ಸ್, ಬಟ್ ಇಟ್ ವಿಲ್ ಬಿ ನೇಮ್ಡ್ ಬೈ ದ ಆಮ್ ಹಿಯರ್. ಸೊ ದಿಸ್ ಈಸ್ ಅಬೌಟ್ ದ ಡಿಫ್ರೆನ್ಸ್ ಬಿಟ್ವೀನ್ ಪ್ರೊಸೆಸರ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ದ controller. So as I told you, Cortex M3 processor is the central processing unit of a controller chip. In addition to the other components are required for the whole Cortex M3 processor based system, means along with this processor you require other additional components in order to work, make it to work as a microcontroller here. So next, what are the different architecture versions we have? So we have four different architecture versions. One is the Cortex-A, as I told you, it is used for developing own embedded system application. Cortex-R for real-time application. Cortex-M for embedded type microcontroller systems. Along with these three, you have classic ARM processor. Under this, you have ARM7 processor, ARM9 processor, and ARM11 processor. So we are going to see what are the different processors that are classified as ARM7, what are the different processors that are classified as ARM9. And ARM11. So all this 7, 9, 11 ARM processor are the different versions of ARM, and they are classified under classic ARM processor category. So first we will see ARM7. So ARM7, the processor which was introduced by ARM7 was ARM7 TDMI-S. S stands for signed, means this particular processor will perform all the operations with respect to the signed input. Signed in the sense you can give the value, even both negative value as well as positive values, along with zero for the particular processor. And this processor has wide range of applications. They are mainly used in handsets, that is the mobile handsets, and they are also used in non-mobile applications as well. So next you have ARM9 family. ARM9, that is ARM968ES, ARM946ES, and ARM926EJS. All these three different families, means three different processors, are categorized under ARM9. So yes, as I already told you, yes stands for signed here. So for the first one, that is 968ES, it is the smallest size processor which will be utilizing less amount of power and tightly coupled memory here, means the memory is utilized in an efficient way and it can be used for real-time applications. So similarly, the next category is 946ES. It is also used in real-time applications. Along with these features, it provides full memory protection unit along with extending the memory size, that is cache interfaces can be done, and tight coupled memory. These are the different features related to this. So next, related to this particular process, it supports different operating systems, and it is small in size, it consumes less amount of memory, it is used in real-time applications, it will also be having a memory protection unit. So what do you mean by memory protection unit? So suppose ಸಿಸ್ಟಮಲ್ಲಿ ಒಂದು ಮೆಮೊರಿಲಿ ಏನೋ ಒಂದು ಪ್ರೋಗ್ರಾಮ್ ಸ್ಟೋರ್ ಮಾಡಿರ್ತೀರ ಅಂತ ತಿಳ್ಕೊಳ್ಳಿ. ಓಕೆನಾ? ಸೊ ದ ಅದರ್ ಪರ್ಸನ್ ಹೂ ಇಸ್ ಕಮ್ಮಿಂಗ್ ಶುಡ್ ನಾಟ್ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಎನಿ ಆ್ಯಕ್ಸೆಸ್ ಟು ದಿಸ್ ಪರ್ಟಿಕ್ಯುಲರ್ ಪ್ರೋಗ್ರಾಮ್. ಮೀನ್ಸ್ ಹಿ ಕೆನ್ ನಾಟ್ ಚೇಂಜ್ ದ ಪ್ರೋಗ್ರಾಮ್ ವಿಚ್ ಇಸ್ ಸ್ಟೋರ್ಡ್ ಇನ್ ದ ಮೆಮೊರಿ, ಆರ್ ಹಿ ಕೆನ್ ನಾಟ್ ಎರೇಸ್ ದ ಪ್ರೋಗ್ರಾಮ್, ನಥಿಂಗ್ ಲೈಕ್ ದಟ್. ಮೀನ್ಸ್ ಹಿ ಕೆನ್ ನಾಟ್ harm the content which is present as the firmware and stored in the system code. So there should be some protection which has to be provided to this memory unit. So there is an option which is called as MPU, that is memory protection unit. If this memory protection unit is enabled and if you are dumping the code into the memory, then whatever the data that is stored within that will be stored in a proper way. Means no other third party or the unauthorized person cannot change the content of this memory, provided this memory protection unit, this particular option, it should be enabled. If it is not enabled, the third party person can change the content or rewrite the content according to his needs. So next you have the last processor, which is categorized as a classic ARM processor, that is ARM 11. Within this also you have three different processors. You have this 76JZ, 56TE and 36JF. F stands for floating, S stands for signed. And the first one, 76JZ, it is a single core processor which provides high speed performance, and it was introduced by TrustZone Technology company, which is used for to enable the particular processor for a secure execution outside the reach of malicious code. Malicious code andre iga virus bandu attack aagde iru tara, this particular whatever the data that will be stored inside the memory will be safeguarded by this particular processor. And next the category is 560E. T stands for thumb here, okay. JZ stands for Jazzle code. J also stands for Jazzle code. So it is of high performance and used in real-time classic families. And the last one is 36J. It follows extended pipelining process and it uses single instruction multiple data operations, and it is very similar to ARM 9 family, which will be supporting different operating systems here. So see here, these are the different ARM processors or controllers which was developed according to the different generations or different versions of architecture. The first version of architecture was V4, next V5, next V6, and the current one was V7. So this is ARM 7, ARM 9 and ARM 11. So these ARM processors are classified as thumb technologies or the classic ARM processors. The first one is HALF7 TDMI. So it is half word or signed word. Yes, as I told you, yes stands for signed. Half word in the sense the total word size is 32 bit, half word in the sense 16 bit. So this particular processor or the controller has the capacity of performing the operations of 16 bit size. Even byte support is also, means even it can give 8 bit data as well. So it will be operating in the normal system mode and it follows thumb instruction set. So for this ARM architecture, you have a different instruction set architecture which is called as thumb instruction set architecture. So this thumb instruction set architecture will be having the instructions related to 16 bit operations. E addition and adding to 16 bits, subtraction with respect to 216 bits. So thumb instruction set and the takshna yavde instructions ho ee thumb instruction set al use martivu adelladannu 16 bit size alla irutte. Clear with that? I hope so. So next you have the improved version of ARM 7, that is ARM 9. This is used for performing the DSP operations. If you want to perform any signal processing operations where you want to multiply, means if you want to find DFT of any particular signal, you want to multiply those signal, you want to accumulate the values, all those things you need to do, right? So such kind of signal processing operations, if you want, you can perform by using this ARM 9. And this is supports ARM 9, improved ARM or thumb instruction set architecture. So next you have the improved version of ARM9, that is ARM11. So here this follows V6 architecture, where V6 architecture has the features as SIMD, that is single instruction multiple data, and it is a multi-core processing system. And it follows Thumb 2 architecture. It was developed by TrustZone, and it is a multi-core architecture, and it also supports Thumb-only also. This Thumb-only is supported for the Cortex-M family. So see here, the next version of architecture is V7, where Thumb architecture is only 16-bit size. ARM instructions can be 32-bit or 64-bit. If it is a 32-bit ARM processor, then it will be performing 32-bit operations at a time. So wherever, if you want to perform 32-bit operations along with the 16-bit operations, then that instruction set architecture is called as Thumb 2 architecture, that we'll see in the next slides as well. So there are different profiles which will follow this version 7, that is Cortex-A, Cortex-R and Cortex-M. So Cortex-A is designed for high performance open application platforms. Cortex-R is designed for real-time performance, means real-time environment, wherever real-time performance is needed. And Cortex-M is designed or used in case of embedded microcontroller type systems. So the A family or the Cortex-A processors are high-end embedded operating, supports high-end embedded operating systems like Symbian, Linux and Windows CE. It has high processing power, and it also supports virtual memory system for proper memory management. So we will see what do you mean by virtual memory system, all those things in the next slides. And it also supports for different applications related to Java here. And it is used in higher end mobile applications, such as I told you, Apple phones, all those things. So next you have Cortex-R. So real-time high-performance processor, which are targeted primarily at the higher end of the real-time market. Wherever you want a real-time embedded system which has to be developed or which is to be worked in a real-time environment, then you can go for this R profiles. So it has a hard drive controllers, high-end braking systems in which the processing power will be high. We can rely on that particular system to a higher extent. And that particular system will be producing low latency. Low latency and the delay will be very less. So the next one which you have is M profile, that is Cortex-M, which will be following version 7 architecture. So these are low cost applications. Cost will be less, power consumption will be less, interrupt latency will be less, and it is used in many of the industrial control applications along with the real-time applications as well. As it follows version 7 architecture of ARM, it is said to be ARM V7M. Okay. So this is how the evolution of ARM processors will be. Can be seen here. So the first one was ARM7, which was following V4 architecture. Next ARM9, V5 architecture, ARM11 and Cortex-M0 and M1, which will be following V6 architecture. Next from Cortex-M family, that is starting from M3, M5, M6 and M7, all will be following V7 architecture. Along with this Cortex-M, we have Cortex-A and Cortex-R, which will be following V7 architecture of ARM. So these are the ARM7, ARM9, ARM11 are the classic processors. M0 to M4 are the embedded Cortex processors, Cortex-M processors, Cortex-R. Next you have Cortex-A. So these are the different processors and the controllers which we have related to ARM family. So next we'll see what are the different operating system the ARM supports and what are the tools that are used for programming these ARM processors or the controllers. So here is some of the operating systems which we have here. So you have Linux, QNX, VXLux, Hoox, Microcontroller Linux, FreeRTOS. So these are some of the operating systems which are listed here. So similarly, you have some of the tools which are used in order to program these ARM controllers. You have विन ड्राइवर वर्कबेंच कोड सोर्सरी ग्रीन हिल स्कील सॉफ्टवेयर रियल व्यू IIR वर्कबेंच सो दिस आर द IDE टूल्स सो व्हाट इज IDE इंटीग्रेटेड डेवलपमेंट एनवायरनमेंट IDE स्टैंड्स फॉर इंटीग्रेटेड डेवलपमेंट एनवायरनमेंट सो वी हैव ऑलरेडी सीन व्हाट इज द यूज ऑफ IDE व्हाट विल बी देयर इन IDE ऑल दीज थिंग्स इन द फिफ्थ मॉड्यूल सो IDE विल बी हैविंग इट्स ओन टेक्स्ट एडिटर कंपाइलर डीबगर ऑल दोज थिंग्स along with the simulator and the linker means everything under a single software tool platform is said to be an IDE tool so these are the different IDE tools which are used for writing the programs related to this ARM so similarly it has some open source tools as well so Egarto and NeuRAM are the open source tools which you have you can freely download these two softwares in order to program this particular ARM So the one software which you are using for your programming in lab is the Keel Microvision 4 software. So the next we are going to learn about the instruction set development. So as I told you, ARM7 was of 16-bit processor, means the max. It was following the thumb instruction set. So the thumb instruction set, as I told you, it will be of about 16-bit. Size but later on from Cortex M3 the size of ARM has been increased from 16 bit to 32 bit so whatever the ARM instructions that you are using related to Cortex M3 that instruction should support even this thumb instruction set which is of 16 bit size and it should also support 32 bit size instruction set as well so if you are using 16 even you can use 16 bit values as inputs for the 32 bit controller right so there can be dynamically switching operation that can take place between the ARM state which will be having 32 bit instruction size and thumb state which will be having 16 bit instruction set so it can switch between ARM state and the thumb state for proper execution of the code wherein I can say this thumb instruction set is a subset of this 32 bit instruction set which is called as ARM set here so in order to provide the end user with high code density we can switch the processor between the ARM state and the thumb state so but this switching operation can also produce certain latency so we are going for the next instruction set architecture in the that I'll explain in the next slide so there in order to overcome that latency we have updated and we have ARM has been updated with extra instruction set where it can support both ARM instruction and thumb instruction at the same time if suppose just an example I can tell you if I am using the instruction as add R0 and R1 okay if I am having this instruction so what does this perform I will add R0 R1 let me give SIMD stands for single instruction multiple data by using a single instruction I am operating on three different datas here so here R0 is a 32 bit register let me think means all the by default all the registers will be 32 bit and R1 is a 16 bit value R1 has a 16 bit value but the size of R1 is 32 bit and even this R2 is a 32 bit register so if I am using a 16 bit value which will be added with 32 bit the resultant will be 32 bit itself so if I am using thumb and ARM in the sense here it has to be switched between the 16 bits instruction set as well as the 32 bit instruction set which produce latency little bit of latency to overcome that the ARM has been introducing the next level of instruction set architecture which is called as thumb-2 instruction architecture where there won't be any switching between 16 bit level instructions as 32 bit level instructions it will be means this particular instruction set supports both the things without both the 16 bit and 32 bit instructions without any switching operation so that the latency can be reduced here So this is an important question. They'll ask you about write a note on Thumb 2 technology or write a note on Thumb 2 ISA. ISA stands for instruction set architecture. So Thumb 2, in the sense, this instruction set will be having 32-bit level instructions as well as 16-bit level instructions. Means 32-bit level instructions is nothing but ARM instructions, and 16-bit is said to be the thumb instructions. So a combination of ARM instructions and thumb instructions are said to be Thumb 2 instructions. Okay, so Thumb 2 technology extended the thumb instruction set into a highly efficient and powerful way in order to write the code in a with the more number of benefits. We can use 16-bit code and the 32-bit code to increase the performance and to reduce the size of the code. So it contains 16-bit thumb instruction set as well as 32-bit ARM instruction set. So both are these are combined to perform or to give higher efficiency, such that the number of switching states can be reduced between the ARM state and the thumb state. So see here, so this is thumb instruction set. So this is the 32-bit instruction set. This is called as ARM instruction set, which we have here. So both the things are a part of this Thumb 2 technology, where you can have 32-bit and 16-bit as the subsets of this particular ISA. So this Cortex-M3 supports Thumb 2 instruction set architecture. So instead of using separate ARM architecture, which is of size 32-bit, and thumb architecture, which is of size 16-bit, we can perform both the operations under a single instruction set architecture, such that we can reduce the switching between those two ISAs, that is instruction set architecture. So that particular ISA is called as Thumb 2 technology. So what if you are using Thumb 2 technology, as I told you, we will be getting the code, or you can design the code with higher code density, and it can provide higher performance with no extra complexity. So next we will see the applications. Where can you find the applications of Cortex M3? And according to your syllabus, you are going to learn about this Cortex M3. And the same Cortex M3 is used in your lab also for doing your experiments. So a brief description about Cortex M3. It is a low-cost microcontroller. So wherever you are, you want to design a low-end embedded system where cost is considered as a primary factor, you can go for this Cortex M3. Similarly, in case of automotive systems, wherever in a real-time application, if you want, you can use this Cortex M3. You have about 240 interrupts, which are external interrupts, which are supported by M3 here. And all the ISR routines can be written by the user itself. So you have 240 interrupts. You can rewrite the ISR routine according to your needs, and you have optional memory protection unit here. So these are the different features of Cortex M3. So next you have this Cortex M3 can also be used in the communication field, where the data can be sent through Bluetooth and Zigbee. Means even these particular components are supported by this M3 processor. It can be used in industrial control applications where the latency is less, and enhanced fault handling features, which makes its use for as a strong candidate to be used in this particular industrial controlling area. Next, you can use in the consumer products, where the size of the processor should be small, it should perform with a higher efficiency, it consumes less power. If you want all these things to be the features of your system, then you can use this Cortex M3 there as well. So the advantages is greater performance efficiency, means it allows you to work without increasing the frequency, without utilizing more amount of machine cycles. It allows you to get the work done with the proper utilization of all the machine cycles. Next, low power consumption. it operates means if it is operating on the AC power, it operates, it consumes less power. Even if it is operating on the battery used within itself, we can have the battery life for a longer time as utilizes less amount of power. Next, enhanced determinism means wherever you want to perform any critical task, then you can use this particular Cortex-M3. Next, the improved core density, as it supports Thumb 2 technology, the maximum size of the core can also be reduced here. So even in small memory, the complete core can be downloaded and imprinted on the system core. Ease of use means the programmer has the facility to switch between 16-bit and 32-bit and 8-bit instruction size, so the programmer can easily write the program according to the requirements. Low cost solution, the cost will be very less, and you have a wide range of development tools which are used for supporting this Cortex-M3. I had told you here, you have wide range of tools which are used for writing the program, so you have many of these tools in order to process this Cortex-M3. So you can use any of those tools to write your program. So in the next class, we'll see with the architecture. Just a brief review I'll tell you. So this is the architecture of Cortex-M3. So you'll be having an interrupt controller that is called as non-vectored. NVIC is nothing but non-vectored interrupt controller. So you have two different types of interrupts category. One is vectored interrupts, wherein the ISR routine, if any interrupt occurs, then the interrupt will be going to the ISR routine. It will execute and it will come back. Means there is a vectored, those are called as vectored interrupts, where the ISR routine for the different interrupts is specified and it is specific with respect to this. But here you have 240 interrupts, and all those interrupts are written by the end user. So those are categorized as non-vectored interrupts. Next, this particular Cortex-M3 follows three stages of pipelining: fetching, decoding, and executing. So you have fetching and decoding, and for execution you'll be using the registers, all those things. So all these three stage pipelining is also supported by the memory and the ARM processor as well. So you have a trace unit. So trace unit is something which acts as an interface between the processor and the external hardware which you are going to connect. Okay, so next you have a debugging system which is used for debugging the code which you are going to use with respect to the system. Next you have a memory protection unit. So memory protection unit, as I told you, whatever the data that you are storing in the memory, if the third party or the other unauthorized person, if he does not want to get any access to that particular content, then this memory protection unit should be enabled. So that means you have a memory protection unit which is supported by the instruction bus as well as the data bus here. Next, you have a debug interfaces. This debug interface is related to the debug system, which will be performing the debugging operations related to the different programming operations that are done. All the interconnections are done with respect to the bus architecture, which is provided by this ARM, which is called as AMBA. AMBA. So AMBA is the bus architecture which is supported by the ARM. So through this bus architecture, you can interface your code memory and different peripherals and the private peripherals for your system. So this is about the architecture of Cortex-M3, and this is also a very important question. So it has a 32-bit data bus, and you have 32-bit bit size register bank. And all the memory interfaces which you are doing here, even those interfaces will be of size 32-bit. And as I told you, ARM follows RISC architecture. It is nothing but it will be following Harvard architecture. In the sense, you'll be having different bus for using with respect to instructions and with respect to data, such that the parallel operations of instructions and the data can be taken in order to increase the performance. Next means it allows the instructions and data to be accessed at the same time. It has a unified memory in the sense, in order to store the instruction as well as the data, it will be sharing the same memory space for both the things. So it has multiple bus interfaces on Cortex-M3, each with respect to the usage and ability of the different buses will be done at the simultaneous time. So next you have a memory protection unit, and this memory protection unit is optional. If you want, you need to enable that. If you want, you can connect the cache memory externally. If whatever the memory that is inbuilt, whatever the thing that you have, if it is not enough to store your code in that, you can enhance the memory by connecting the external cache memory. And this particular Cortex-M3 supports both the Little Indian and the Big Indian memory system. I hope you are remembering about the Little Indian and the Big Indian memory system. If this is a memory, if the data stored here is, if the memory locations are 20, 21, 22, and 23, just an example I'm taking here. Okay, according to Little Indian, the LSB will be started from here and MSB will be started at last. Okay, but in case of Big Indian, MSB will be started at this point, and in the next locations it will be starting until the LSB bit. So both the particular Little Indian format of storing the data and Big Indian format of storing the data in the memory are supported by this Cortex-M3. And as you are using different tools, debugging tools here, the IDE tools, all these IDE tools are enriched with the breakpoints and the watch points. So watch point is nothing but, suppose if I have a counter, okay, so suppose the counter content is shown in the register R0, so I can use a watch point here and I can watch how the value of R0 is changing at what time. R0 has been changed to 1, R0 has been changed to 2, 3, 4, 5, means I am watching the content of R0 by putting a watch point here. So similarly, I have breakpoints. So if I have a program of 10 instruction set, and if I want to execute only 5 instructions and I want to see the content of the registers, means what is the status of the program after executing the 5 instructions of the program, then I can put a breakpoint at the 5th point of an instruction. So we have many such features which are supported by the debugging tools or the development tools which are used in the ARM Cortex-M3. And as I told you, it supports 3-stage pipelining process. The first one is fetch. It will fetch the instruction, it will decode into opcode, and it will execute. And it has a unified memory space, means the same memory is used for storing both the data as well as the instruction. So it is the internal memory which is stored, means the internal memory space available within the Cortex-M3 is 4 GB, and the instruction set is of about 32-bit size. As I told you, the bus architecture is unique for this ARM, that is AMBA, that is called as Advanced Microcontroller Bus Architecture. So this is the bus architecture which is supported by all the ARM processors in order to provide higher throughput operations. Higher throughput andre input kotti takshna without any variation, by utilizing less amount of time, the work has been completed. So that is called as higher throughput. And as I told you, all the interrupts which are supported by this Cortex-M3 have vectored interrupts as well as non-vectored interrupts. In non-vectored interrupts, you have about 240 interrupts, and each and every interrupt is prioritized. The priority will be starting from 8 to 256. 8 is the lowest, highest priority, and 256 is the lowest priority. So how about priority from 0 to 7? You have inbuilt vectored interrupts which is having the priority from 0 to 7. From 8 to 256, those priority levels are assigned for non-vectored interrupts here. So next you have a system tick timer with respect to this particular Cortex-M3, and you have a shadowed stack pointer, and it has different modes also wherein you can operate the system even in sleep mode for proper utilization of the power. And as I had already told you, it supports memory protection unit. So whatever the data, if you want to store, if it has to be secured, then this particular option should be enabled. Next, you have different bit band instructions, means you can operate the different register set content with respect to each and every bit, or each and every bit of a register, or each and every bit of a memory. You have different bit band related operations here, and it also supports single processor or multiprocessor designs. So with respect to registers, you have totally 16 registers. All these registers are of 32 bit size. So 16 registers, in the sense you have register R0 to R15. So within that, only until R12, from R0 to R12, only this can be used for ALU operations. So next, R13, R14 and R15 are used for some other purpose. So the by default registers which are used with respect to the ALU operations are until R12. So R13 is used as a stack pointer. R14 is used as a link register. So usually link register is nothing but, so whenever you have a program, if I call a function, it will execute the function and it will come back to the main program. So for coming back to the main program, I need to store the address of the program wherever it has been stopped at the previous point. So that address will be stored in this link register. So link register is used to store the address from if any subroutine has been occurred. Next, you have R15, which is called as a program counter. So program counter is used for storing the address of the current instruction that is executed. So these are the different set of registers which we have here. In the next class, we will be seeing what are the in detail what is a stack pointer, how those stack pointers, all those things are accessed, all those things. So we'll end up the class now. ಗೊತ್ತಿಲ್ಲ, ನಾನು ಮೊನ್ನೆ ಟ್ರೈ ಮಾಡಿದಾಗೂ ಆಗಲಿಲ್ಲ.